Tänään meillä on puhumassa filosofian professori Josef Almog, teoreettisen filosofian dosentti Hanne Appelqvist ja moderaattorina toimii Anssi Ollilainen. Aiheena meillä on tänään Religion, Beauty and Suffering. How do God, pain and beauty relate to each other?
So, I'm going to talk about Kant and the way in which these three notions that were just mentioned, suffering, religion and beauty, relate to each other. So here it goes. Bad things happen to good people. When we look at the world around us, we see injustice flourishing, good deeds going unrewarded, and fortuitous suffering burdening the lives of innocent people. Nor do we have any reason to believe that such injustices can be eliminated from the world. Even if everybody adopted Kant's categorical imperative and acted only on principles that they would want other people to follow as well, still natural catastrophes, devastating illnesses, and simple bad luck would intervene and result in human suffering. Kant, perhaps the most important philosopher of early modern thought, expressed this disharmony between our sense of justice and the empirical events of the world by reference to his distinction between nature and morality, which he saw as two domains of thought independent of one another. He writes, "Everything in nature works in accordance with laws. Only a rational being has the capacity to act in accordance with the representation of laws, in accordance with principles, or has a will. For theoretical reason, which seeks knowledge, nature is a mere mechanistic aggregate of facts determined by laws of nature that are beyond our control. And the human being itself, if approached from the perspective of knowledge, is a mere empirical creature subject to laws of nature." However, Kant emphasized that from the perspective of practical reason, from the perspective of agency and action, the human being cannot think of herself exclusively as such. Instead, she must think of herself as an agent, think of herself as capable of acting towards some ends, goals, or purposes, and in doing so, act in accordance with principles that originate not in nature, but in her own practical reason. So what this means is that for Kant, my ethically relevant will does not belong to the domain of nature. Rather, my will, which is nothing but practical reason for Kant, is capable of rising above nature by following laws that originate in itself, and ultimately the will is responsible to what Kant calls the moral law. Now, for Kant, this moral law is not a formula given to the subject by some external authority like my mother or even God. Rather, the moral law is the principle of universalizability. Insofar as something is a reason for me to act in a certain way, it ought to be a reason for everyone else as well. Unlike many practical choices that are based on calculations on the consequences of one's action, the moral law is unconditional. There are no excuses, but importantly, no promises of a recompense either, at least insofar as recompense is understood as an empirical fact of nature. For no empirical consequences among the facts of nature should be among the determining grounds of my will, insofar as my will is to be a good will. Insofar as my will is good, I must do the right thing quite irrespectively of what I calculate to follow from my action. So I may foresee that telling the truth, say, will have unfortunate empirical consequences for myself, and perhaps more generally too. The only consolation I am given is that even if doing the right thing for the right reason does not lead to my happiness, at least I have been worthy of happiness. So this break between morality on the one hand and happiness on the other again reflects the gulf between nature and morality as domains responsive to qualitatively different kinds of laws, independent of and irreducible to one another. There are, as it were, two different worlds that do not seem to interact in any way, hence leaving the expectation that being good will lead to happiness, if not futile, at least unsupported. But it is really hard to let go of the idea that at the end of the day, the good ought to be rewarded and bad punished. And indeed, Kant suggests that there is something right in the idea that morality and happiness ought to be somehow connected. Despite the fact that in the empirical, sensible world, we see bad things happening to good people and good intentions leading to unfortunate consequences, our practical reason assumes that moral efforts cannot be in vain. Kant expresses this idea by reference to his concept of the highest good. This highest good is the idea of a distribution of happiness in proportion to moral worth. In other words, the idea that ultimately justice will prevail and good deeds are not in vain. Now, as mentioned, the source of this idea cannot be found in nature, but the source is rather in the practical reason itself. The point is that if something, namely the promotion of the highest good, is demanded of me by the moral law, then it must be possible. But how can we think of the highest good as possible? And this is where notions formative of religious faith come in. For Kant's response to this question brings in notions of God and the soul's immortality. First, in Kant's view, the moral law demands nothing less than perfection, that is, complete conformity of the will with the moral law. And yet, such perfection is an impossible goal for us as empirical creatures. Hence, we are led to assume the possibility of an endless progress towards perfection. And this possibility, of course, requires immortality and eternity. Second, a harmony between happiness and morality cannot be expected in the sensible world, as I mentioned. And yet, again, practical reason assumes that such a harmony must be possible, and this leads to the assumption of God, a rational being causing the world by his will for a certain purpose. The idea is that if the world has been designed for the purpose of the moral vocation of the human being, then we have grounds to hope, if not know, that nature will somehow, at the end of the day, accommodate our moral efforts, be hospitable to our moral goals. And this is not to say that Kant takes himself to have given a proof of immortality or God's existence. From the perspective of theoretical reason, knowledge, God's existence is a mere hypothesis. From the perspective of practical reason, in turn, it is a belief arising from pure reason. And neither hypotheses nor beliefs amount to knowledge. Moreover, importantly, for Kant, the normative pull of morality does not rely on the postulate of God's existence, but precedes religious faith. It is only when the subject acknowledges the absolute demand of morality that the hope of a just distribution of happiness in accordance with morality can arise in the first place. Put in slightly different terms, in Kant's view, there is no duty to believe in God. The only duty that arises from the moral law is to strive to promote the highest good. Yet, the realization of the moral demand may lead or leads to a need, a subjective need, to assume that there is a God who, as the intentional ground of the world, will guarantee the possibility of an ultimate harmony between the goodwill and happiness. Kant himself acknowledges that his account of nature and morality as two domains independent of one another has a certain affinity with the Christian faith. By contrast to some ancient philosophers who argued that the connection between morality and happiness is empirical, by arguing, for example, that to be virtuous is simply to be happy, like the Stoics did, Christianity acknowledges the gulf between the empirical world and the absolute demand of morality that cannot be explained by reference to nature. So Kant writes, "Christian morals deprives the human being of confidence that he can be fully adequate to it, at least in this life, but again sets it up by enabling us to hope that if we can act as well as is within our power, then what is not within our power will come to our aid from another source, whether or not we know in what way." Kant takes up this aid from another source later in his third critique, the Critique of the Power of Judgment, which is known for its influential analysis of a judgment of beauty. What is at stake in this book is, again, the seeming gulf between the sensible empirical world on the one hand, the empirical world of which we can have knowledge, and the intelligible world of freedom, intentional agency, and, we hope, God as the ultimate guarantee of justice. Kant's question is whether we have the right to see the world around us as if designed for a certain purpose, in such a way that would, first, make sense of intentional action as directed towards some ends, where intentional action is understood as flowing from a will capable of setting its own ends. But also, second, make sense of the world itself being hospitable for our moral efforts, so that the pursuit of the highest good doesn't seem as hopeless as the perspective of knowledge suggests. So here is Kant's own rather difficult formulation of the challenge, but one I think is worth mentioning anyway, or citing. Kant writes in the third critique, "Now, although there is an incalculable gulf fixed between the domain of the concept of nature as the sensible and the domain of the concept of freedom as the supersensible, so that from the former, nature that is, to the latter, nature, thus by means of the theoretical use of reason, no transition is possible. Just as if there were so many different worlds, the first of which can have no influence on the second. Yet, the latter should have an influence on the former. Namely, the concept of freedom should make its end that is imposed by its laws real in the sensible world." And here the law is, of course, ultimately the moral law. "And nature must consequently also be able to be conceived in such a way that the lawfulness of its form is at least in agreement with the possibility of the ends that are to be realized in it in accordance with the laws of freedom." So that was rather difficult. But the idea is that there is this, Kant restates the claim that there is this incalculable gulf between the intelligible world, which inhabits the subject not as a creature of nature, but as an intentional agent responsible to the moral law on the one hand, and nature that is a mere mechanism of facts determined by laws of nature. And somehow this gulf ought to be bridged. And Kant argues that there must be a way in which we see nature lawful in such a way that these two worlds can actually come together in a harmonious way, so that the will can actually bring about the goal or the end that it or that it has to strive for, namely the promotion of the highest good. So here is what Kant does in the third critique. He argues that there are, in fact, two perspectives one may adopt towards the world. And these are also the two perspectives I may adopt towards myself, namely myself as an empirical creature, an animal, and myself as a moral agent. The first perspective is the perspective operative in the pursuit of knowledge about the facts of nature, where those facts and objects are determined under concepts of understanding, and the world appears as a causal mechanism, allowing no knowledge of purposes, freedom, God, or even the world understood as a whole. But in addition to this, Kant now claims, there is another perspective which allows us to see natural organisms, actions, objects, and states of mind as purposive, as goal-directed. This is to say that the second perspective, which Kant calls reflective, shows these phenomena from a teleological viewpoint by contrast to the causal one, which is nothing but to look at the world as if it were intended for a certain purpose, and in doing so, inevitably assuming a will that has arranged the world in such a way, that will belonging to God. Now, perhaps somewhat surprisingly, Kant's strategy in establishing the legitimacy of this second reflective perspective is to turn to the judgment of beauty. This is because a judgment of beauty, according to Kant, is just the kind of a judgment that sees its object as if intended for a certain purpose without the possibility of conceptually expressing what that purpose might be. Now, Kant is careful to stress that judgments of beauty do not amount to knowledge because they rely on the subject's own personally felt pleasure in the contemplation of the form of the object. In other words, Kant wants to keep his strict conception of knowledge intact by granting the status of knowledge only to those thoughts that have concepts and empirical content. Yet at the same time, he's appealing to the experience that when I claim something to be beautiful, I'm stating more than a mere subjective preference or a simple empirical response to a stimulus. Even though I make a judgment of beauty based on my own feeling that I experience in the non-conceptual and disinterested contemplation of the form of the object, I still demand, though I do not predict, but I demand that others agree with me. As Kant himself put it, I claim that the relation between the form of the representation of the object and my subjectively felt pleasure is necessary, even though I cannot prove this by conceptual arguments. And Kant dedicates the great bulk of the third critique to the task of showing that we indeed have the right to make such claims. When I say that a given performance of the jazz standard Two Different Worlds is beautiful or harmonious, I have the right to demand agreement from you, provided that my judgment of beauty is based on a disinterested contemplation of the form of the musical performance. So for Kant, beauty is not a property of objects that we could conceptually isolate and then claim to know that this has the property of being beautiful and that doesn't. Instead, beauty is a kind of a judgment I make, a certain way of seeing an object. Kant's own definition of beauty is that it is the form of the purposiveness of an object insofar as it is perceived in it without representation of an end or purpose. In other words, when I make a judgment of beauty or one of these crustaceans, which is one of Kant's own examples of a free beauty, I see it as if it were arranged in accordance with the representation of a rule, even when I cannot state what that rule is, that is, even when I cannot establish the object's purpose from the viewpoint of knowledge. But as suggested above, it is not just beauty that is at stake here. We assume similar purposiveness when we treat human behavior not as mere behavior in the empirical realm, but as intentional action. So by establishing the legitimacy of the judgment of beauty, Kant takes to have shown that we may legitimately see not only artworks, but also our own action in a teleological, purpose-oriented way, as if springing from a will. And most importantly, nature itself as a whole may be seen as if organized by a supersensible will for a particular purpose. The world whole may be seen, as it were, as a work of art, and as such, as evoking the idea of a will that has arranged it for a specific purpose. Now, that ultimate purpose, of course, being no other than the moral vocation of the human being, as understood as the only unconditional purpose, not springing from nature, my natural inclinations and desires, but from the principle of the will itself, the moral law. This is not to back off from Kant's original claim that we cannot have knowledge of freedom, God, or immortality. Still, by establishing the legitimacy of the powerful experience of beauty as a judgment that doesn't merely reflect the laws of nature, but has a transcendental ground, as Kant states, he takes to have shown that we have the right to judge nature as purposive, hospitable for our moral efforts. This is to say that we have the right to hope that at the end of the day, the absolute demand of morality and happiness will come together in harmony. Thank you.
So I'm not going to talk about Kant much, but about someone in contrast to Kant. And I want you to understand, it's not out of disrespect to this great figure, and you just got a wonderful lesson from... If you want to understand Kant, I always say to some of my students, like, go and talk to Hanne, because she... And this is while I teach Kant. I've been teaching, I think, now in succession, I don't know, it's just four terms, or... I'm teaching tomorrow morning at 8:30, the aesthetic, you know, we're in page 3 or something after 8 weeks or something. So it's not out of disrespect to the great figure and how wonderful he is, but he's a very complicated figure, and perhaps the most complicated figure I ever read, and I came late to him, that is late in my 40s and so on, even more than Spinoza, who is already quite complicated. And part of the complication I'm going to talk about, not by talking about Kant, it's this language that he's using. If you saw these, I mean, you have a fantastic translator in Hanne who breaks through the bullshit. But the, behind the systems and the words and all that, there was a very serious philosopher who, I don't know why, psychologists can talk about it, talked like, you know, the language of the priest as opposed to the language of the current pope who's trying to break through this. So it's not that Kant is not interesting, and I'll make points of contact with Kant, I'll say. But I want to contrast something that's coming from Kant with some other approach to, I don't even know what exactly it is. It's not just beauty and suffering, but it's in some sense the approach to being, to existence, of all of us and humanity's place in it. Essentially, I'm going to quote a couple of my people. My people are not Kant, but they're artists, a musician and a great writer, so they're not philosophers. But let me speak the third person first, Joseph. So I'm a philosopher, right? So we need some paradox or antinomy, as Kant likes to say. You know, some place that you all know, Kant very famously has a murderer at his doorstep. This is late in his life. And he tells us that you have to tell the murderer where your friend is hiding under the bed, and it's your duty to tell the murderer the truth and tell him, here's Freddy, he's here. And he says very famously, fiat justitia, this is Latin. Kant is always doing a bit of Latin to feel strong. Fiat justitia eperat mundus. Do justice or make justice, which for him was a construction. Construct something like justice and let the world perish. And what I want to say on behalf of some of my distinguished nature interpreters, these artists, and religious, I think, thinkers, is the opposite, which is fiat mundus, and you don't make it, but let the world be, because we're not making the world. And let everything else go to hell, because once you made the world, you have all these other things that he thinks he's making, justice and beauty and morality. Make the world, and you made them in tow. And in some sense, you can see the dilemma as, I want to say, it's either self or world, but not both. Make self, you destroy the world. Make world, you'll have to destroy self. Self is not you or me. I'm a human being, you're a human being. This is a dog being, this is a crocodile, whatever. Self is a philosophical invention about something that's in me, in some sense. My rational part, my autonomous part, the will that I have. So don't take the word self to mean what it means in ordinary English. Like, as for myself, I'll be down at 4:30. That's a reflexive pronoun. Self here means a construction that carries all the morality and all the justice and all the higher claims that are not the empirical. So when I say let the self go to hell, I don't mean shoot me or I'll be gone. I mean some conception of what's special about me will be gone. And this is what I want to work with, because I have a couple of guys who say to Kant, self will destroy the world. Beauty will save the world. It's this contrast I want to work. And Kant, since he sees the self, Kant the formal philosopher, as I said, he's a very complicated guy, you know, a man with 1,000 faces, and probably at the end, he wants to be here. But I'm talking about the Kant of the official documents, as it were. This is my Robert Mueller on Kant. Not, never mind where he really is. As far as the evidence goes. Self is the basis. It's the ground zero. And from this, there will be first what we call in philosophy epistemology. I see a lot of faces here from philosophy, so I'm not going to explain. A theory of knowledge about the limits of experience and what we can know. Before anything else, like the frame, almost like a logic. You can't fuck around with this. That's the basic, the frame where everything's going to happen. Then, from this, there will be morality. Which for him is not just to say that you're good or bad. It's a whole construction of principles and derivations and stuff. Again, a logic of a certain kind. And then, aesthetics. And while he does this within this restricted bona fide epistemology, you know, in response to you, not to have excesses, all within the bounds of accepted norms of justification. It's a big, you can call it justification theory. Justification theory. A bit like a lawyer. The bounds with which we can argue and rationally communicate. I think the dilemma is that we sacrifice understanding. So another or, either or, is it's either justification or understanding, but not both. If you prime justification, you give up on deep understanding. You'll have understanding within the bounds of justification. If you prime understanding, you may have to give up certain times justification. You might sound mystical or oracular. And what is the argument? There's no argument. There's insight, maybe. There's listening, which I'll try to make you do through my office. At any rate, with the world goes God and space, all these global things. And Kant has things to say about this. Space he's going to say by putting it back here, by idealizing it. That's what I'm teaching tomorrow morning. It's very hard. God and world, the whole world, not just the world of Hollywood, the whole world. So not used metaphorically, the mundus unus, as Kant. The one world, the whole of being. Can't talk about it with the justification theory. And God also is gone. And Kant is correct in his critique, in my view, of how theologians and philosophers have talked about God, really basically lost the real thing and moved it over here, you know, made definitions of the attributes, you know, all these attributes, and like a logical God that you could do derivations and justifications of. If it's God, he's omnipotent, you know, do logic on. But the real God, beyond epistemology. So, there's a certain image, I think modernity is very much living here. And my two guys that I want you to be sensitized by, they speak better than me. I'll let them play, and then I'll say a few words and shut up. And dialogue with Hanne. The difference between us is not as deep as it might seem. Because I know the tricks they do over here. And in her heart, she's like Hanne. So it's a question of the giving of the apple. And you know. So. Before I let my two witnesses come in, let me just say how it ought to unfold here. So here we have world and God, and beauty comes with them, unstoppably. Beauty is not our construction. So two terminological remarks for me, you can take your own way. But beauty, I don't mean aesthetics. I don't mean museums and Picasso and all that. Picasso might be doing something beautiful when he paints something. But the question of what's an aesthetic judgment and what are we saying when we say X is beautiful and is it relative to the eye of the beholder and all these things we just come from. I mean, we're coming from 2 hours of class in aesthetics. That's not my question. Beauty for me is natural beauty before there was any aesthetics and any museums and any, you know, Kant's creative geniuses that do paintings or whatever. Inasmuch as there are pieces of art like, you know, photography, music, whatever, we're going to listen to a beautiful piece of music, it's beautiful because it plays a certain role in nature, not because the guy who plays is a genius. Though he is a genius, actually, I think, personally, as a musician. So beauty is natural beauty, unstoppable beauty, and I'll let in a second my great witness, Dostoevsky, tell you something about it better than I can. And then if morality shows at all, it will emerge from beauty. Which I suspect at the end of his third critique that Hanne mentioned, not his famous work on morals that everybody knows and so on, the imperative, but at the end of his life, when he knew he was dying or close to, I suspect that he saw, against his own, you know, instinct to make up a system of morality with principles and derivations and an epistemology of justification, that the road to morality, to acting right in the world, has a lot to do with a certain attunement to beauty and to the overall nature and to your place in it and so on. At the end of the Critique of Judgment, I think there's very mysterious passages. But in any event, on this view, it's going to work like this. And just as beauty is not aesthetics, not what the music critics say and
justify, look, here's my reasons why the Beethoven is very pretty and so on. Don't be confused about God. I put world and God in the same line. You think I'm confused probably, but I'm not. Don't think God is a guy with a big beard that's sitting in some, you know, chamber and is going to judge you and give you rewards. I mean, Hanne said in passing, well, you know, the reward, the punishment. Don't assume this. Maybe. Maybe if you're good, you're going to get a reward. Maybe if you're bad, you're going to be punished. When I'm jumping into the river to save someone, it's not to get a reward. And maybe there's no reward. At least when we start. So to build it in is to load the dice. When I talk about God, I'm not talking about any person, any judge, or anything like that. Many, including Kant when he was young, in the 1760s, ran the notion of a necessary being, the overall being, that's the cause of all local beings, like me and you, as nature and God at once. He was very affected by Spinoza in those days. It's in Spinoza, these are equivalent notions in some sense. But whatever God is, to me, it's the overallness of cosmic being. If this guy is furthermore with a beard and he's going to reward me, fine. It's nice to go to heaven or whatever. But if not, not. It's already there. Cosmic being is there, whether God is a nice guy or not. And whether he can lift any stone. You know, philosophers have a lot of puzzles about that. So, this is the setup. Self, you go, everything subordinated to self, and the world goes by the board. And here, everything is subordinated to world and God. And there's no self, there's no demigod like me, rational, with a will that can do all these things. There's human being me, that's like dog being, or elephant being, or tree being, or rock being. We have different properties, but we're all equal, so to speak, as cosmic beings. The person whom I want to, two persons, one is a musician, is not a philosopher, is Dostoevsky. He says, and he has Kant on his back mirror. He's attacking the Enlightenment, and in particular, the Kant is the figure de proue, the French say, you know, the kind of the mascot of the Enlightenment. So he says, sorry, give you the tenor. This is not from a fiction, this is from an essay. Notes from the Underground. So he says, to the Western individual, he means us, but just 100 years ago. You know, he was traveling to Berlin, Paris, looking at the modernity, lived in Geneva. To the Western individual who instead demands by force asserting his or her rights, I say, the ideals of liberty, equality, and fraternity, these are the ideals of the French Revolution, and in his mind, very associated with Kant, who supported them, as lived, turn out to be bourgeois sham. And reason cannot provide the road out of this mess. Brotherhood, which is in French the word fraternité, the last of this thing, which was really not in the original French Revolution motif, it was added later. Brotherhood was absent in French and in Western nature generally. In its place was the principle of individuality, the principle of isolation, of intensified self-preservation, of self-seeking, of self-determination within one's own personality or self, capital S, self. Of contrast between this self and the whole of nature and the rest of humanity, as if a battle. He says, and he says now the most pretty, in my view, conclusion. It is not the individual personality, not the self, that should lay claim to its right of equality in value and importance with all the rest, like myself with all the rest. But all this rest should itself approach the individual, the separate self laying this claim, and should itself, without being asked, recognize the individual. You should recognize me. Recognize the individual as its equal in value and rights, the equal of all else that exists in the world. Not just human or rational. No selection. You know, we're not in
in one of these segregationist selections, you know, that if you have the property, we're going to put you over here, and if you don't, go to hell. All else that exists in the world, just by existing in the world. Nay more, the individual who rebels and makes claims should much rather sacrifice both his personality and the whole of himself to society, and not only claim his rights, but on the contrary, hand them over unconditionally to society. Mankind first, then me. Not mankind, I'm going to relate to in a certain way, as Kant suggests, because each of you is like me. If I put myself, I can see myself in you, and then I have to constrain myself not to kick you into something. You're not great because you're like me. I'm great because I'm, and you're great in the sense of great, because you are all together descending from this family tree. Says Dostoevsky. I don't want to run too late, but let me say more Dostoevsky and less of myself. So you'll get the good stuff. We can talk later about what I exactly think. So this is a very famous place where, you know, Dostoevsky coins this very beautiful phrase, beauty will save the world. And of course it's been used like, you know, like L'Oreal, I'm worth it or something, you know, it's on cosmetic services. But he meant it very seriously. He was a very serious guy, Dostoevsky, a new life. You know, Kant was walking around Königsberg and writing books. But Dostoevsky saw the byways and the lowest forms of life, as you know, if you read in your high school, the Crime and Punishment, and the Karamazov, and so on. So he, in The Idiot, this book called The Idiot, he's got his guy, Prince Mishkin, who's looking at this picture of this very beautiful, tortured beauty, sort of Russian, who has suffered a lot from her lover. She was young and abused by some rich man who was taking advantage of her. And he's in love with her. He's looking very intensely in this. And there's a room full of people. I'm sure you know of the scene. And the truth is, the Dostoevsky famous line doesn't occur even at that stage, because it's one of the women who looks at him, looking in this intense way, who says to him, to Mishkin, to the idiot, "Such beauty is real power," said Adelaida. "With such beauty as that one might overthrow the world," in some translation, might destroy the world. She returned to her easel thoughtfully. She senses the power of that beauty. And you might think, what has the power to save the world has also the power to destroy the world. They go together. Later, someone says in the novel, kind of ironically, "Is it true, Prince," this is Mishkin, "that once declared that beauty will save the world?" "Great heaven! The prince says that beauty saves the world, and I declare that he only has such playful ideas because he's in love." "Gentlemen, the prince is in love. I guessed it the moment he came in." "Don't blush, Prince. You make me sorry for you. What beauty saves the world? Kolya told me that you are a zealous Christian. Is it so? Kolya says you call yourself a Christian." And in this vein, just before my music, I want to quote you something that some Christian, you will guess who it is, picked up on that passage of beauty save the world and the role of love in such a saving, in being attuned to the beauty of the world, and because of that, being able to relate to things in the world with love, not just to derive what you ought to do because of some principles. You all face this, of acting on and off from principles, of acting out of love. So this person says, and he knows something about Christianity, "Authentic beauty, however, unlocks the yearning of the human heart, the profound desire to know, to love, to go towards the other, to reach for the beyond. If we acknowledge that beauty touches us intimately, that it wounds us, that it opens our eyes,
that we rediscover the joy of seeing, of being able to grasp the profound meaning of our existence in that beauty of the world, the mystery of which we are part. From this mystery, we can draw fullness, happiness, the passion to engage with it every day, and the love for others. So there is here another image of what is going on with us as beings in the world. We are not here, as it were, rational beings processing various principles as if we were doing some mathematics. And don't get me going on mathematics. A lot of you are students of mine that you know that when I open my mouth on mathematics, it goes for half an hour. But actually, mathematics itself works by beauty and not by reasoning, by deductions. A very small part of mathematics works, you know, as a formal system. But there are here two visions of how we go about in the world. That's what I want to get across. I'll play in 60 seconds, Maya, I think, because we're running a bit late. Let me encapsulate these two ideas as you try to listen. Because the problem is about listening, as opposed to justifying and deducing. So there's no doubt that there are methods and channels that are available to the, let's call it the frontal lobe, or the rational part of us beings, and maybe to whales and elephants or whatever. Surely computers are pretty good at this. Of taking some premises and reasoning through them, and getting conclusions, and maybe even practical reasoning. I should do this, because. And Robert Mueller, right? It's all reasoning. Da-da-da-da, evidence, evidence, evidence. Okay, this follows, this doesn't follow. No doubt that we do that. But, says the angle from which I'm coming, this has been, in the main, a destructive project. It has developed in us a delusion about what we are and what makes us exist. And has made us lose the world, because we can't do these deductions about God and world and beauty. So we restrict ourselves more and more to where we can do the trick. It's as if in mathematics, which is my home province, we would reason just about those things that the system can settle. There would be no incompleteness. We wouldn't formulate problems that we cannot decide by some algorithm. But that's not the road of mathematics. And similarly here, I want to propose what we can do with language and reasoning in the rational part is very important and should not be casually put aside. A lot of progress has come from it. But a lot of progress has come from its claim to authority and completeness, that's the only meaningful part in human existence and the primary one. This other picture suggests, no, it's the easy, it's kind of the tip of the iceberg. The real hookup with reality is not through modeling and reasoning and what you might call in our days artificial forms of intelligence, where we just deduce and run algorithms and calculations and deductions, this is out of the other. I mean, I do it for a living, and we all do this. But there's been a reductive aim here that lost us beauty. And with the loss of beauty, a certain contact with the world that's not linguistic and by means of concepts and reasoning. And I believe, I just come from doing 4 hours of this with Olli back in the Sibelius Academy on the role of music. So I give you music as one illustration, as the final piece here, of another form of contact through beauty with the world, which leads to a certain kind of integration and identification with the world that has in it morality, even if it's not the categorical imperative that's a universal sentence where you permute all that stuff that belongs over here. At the end, I'm going to jump to the river and save Hanne if I do that, because of a certain identification, not because of beauty, goes this picture. So to do that, and then put us in the right atmosphere, let me do it fast. It's a 5-minute thing and we'll be done. So, just so you know, when it's going 4 hours, there's a lot of Baron Boehm and Hélène Grimaud and all the classics and Beethoven and so on. We've done a whole class on this and we're still doing it. I am selecting something that's modern, that's yesterday. Because music is music, whether it's Bach or this person you're gonna hear. It's the question is what it channels. What did you say? Will you say that? Because I'm gonna screw it up if I said it. What were you, the thing you said? He's in my music class. About not, you know, the flow diagram not being from self to world, but somehow the music, the idea that you were trying to get with your machine thing.
That,
what does music do there in terms of channeling nature? You had some formulation that was good.
I would say it is an exceptionally powerful force.
Powerful force.
Nature that makes us listen instead of talking about.
Okay. Well, he said it. You're channeling me here and... Let me have the original. It's in a second. So this is, yeah. I wish I could have the lyrics, but you can look later. The lyrics matter a lot. Okay, here we go. This is a live performance, and that has a reason in it. I mean, live performance has more of that force that Yussi is talking about. Thank you.
Thank you.
So, Joseph, you were suggesting that there is some kind of a deep disagreement between the two of us. And I have difficulty putting my finger on the point of disagreement, where it exactly lies. Because if the main message that you wanted to bring to the table was that the way in which we encounter the world is not exclusively discursive based on reason and conceptual thinking and logical calculations, but there is another way in which we encounter the world, namely the aesthetic way, then we are in total agreement. So that can hardly be the disagreement between the two of us. And for a second thing, I thought you to be suggesting that the experience of beauty, or to use Kant's terminology, the judgment of beauty, is the primary manifestation of that other way of encountering the world, the intuitive, sensuous way. Then there too, we seem to be in agreement. So I guess I'd like to invite you to sort of elaborate a bit more, because you were saying that you are trying to lure me into the other way, on the other side of the line, the demarcation line. I thought I was already there. So,
do you have others? Because once I start talking, you know me, it's dangerous.
Okay, well, okay.
Why stop you then?
maybe
you
can
try.
Maybe I can add one more thing. It was the notion of the world. That, to me, the beauty of Kant's philosophy is in the fact that he's capable of talking about the world in different ways, that there are different aspects of the world depending on the perspective that you adopt. So that first, we do have this discursive, conceptually driven approach to the world, and if we adopt this perspective, then the world is a mere mechanistic aggregate of facts determined by the laws of nature. However, if we abandon the perspective of knowledge and adopt the other perspective, the reflective perspective, then the world is revealed to us as a whole. And I was wondering in which sense of the term world you were talking in your presentation, whether you were talking about the world simplicité, or whether you were actually already implying the second conception of the world, namely the world as a whole, and perhaps a purposive whole, and if so, were you rejecting Kant's idea that, okay, that's a notion that we cannot bring into our conception of, or bring into our corpus of knowledge, and yet we are justified in thinking about the world in that way. So maybe it was the same question, but from two different perspectives.
Other people want to ask about this? So we collect before I say something. So, shall I go?
Maybe you need to go so that everybody can see where the disagreement between us is, if there is one.
Well, I don't want to put it in terms of disagreement. It's hard to know whether it's disagreement that's at some professional, terminological level, and what's going on at the deeper level. Let me make one theoretical remark, and one more, I think, important kind of political or moral remark. Practical, sort of not as metaphysicians. So, I think the problem is inside Kant. Kant is a very, I don't want to bullshit too long here about Kant. Those people who want to study Kant can come to classes on Kant. We do a lot of Kant around here. But I think Kant is very ambivalent and probably torn. There might be deep reasons in the time and how modernity went shows that he was right in some sense to be torn, because modernity went with one Kant and not the other. So Kant is a very, as I said, complicated figure. Let's put it this way. Descartes, who was before Kant and has been misrepresented by many people, including by Kant, has a very clear stance. He thinks that the starting of philosophy, unlike what people later have said, apostles have said about it, that the starting point of philosophy is, when I say I exist, which you all famously, or I think, you know, which is famously cogito, the beginning point, it isn't really the beginning point. Because in I exist, says Descartes, is the recognition that there is existence, capital E. I'm part of existence. And that capital E existence, the being, the infinitary being, is not limited like me or you. And what I assert in some sense, this is a point actually that Koistinen has made very beautifully in various writings. By the way, he asked forgiveness. He's in Rome, you know, thinking about beauty. And he wished to be with us, but he's not. But he knew that I would mention him. So Descartes says we start with the infinitary being, and I see myself as part of that. I'm a limitation of him. I'm, as it were, participating in that being. And then there's various constructions in the meditations, what it is for me to have a mind and a body and to think about other things and all that. But I'm thinking about God outright. So it's very non-Kantian in the professional sense, because if I wasn't thinking about God, I wouldn't be thinking about anything. So you could say the real cogito is if I think, I think of God and God exists. Not if I think I exist. That's true too. But the primary cogito is the God cogito and so on. So from the very beginning, you see yourself as a piece of God, so to speak, a piece of, you know, the overall being, which he also says is nature in its most general respect. So he doesn't quite, I mean, all these issues whether God is nature, I'm putting aside now. Kant has this side in a very deep way. I don't think he ever lost it. He had it early in his career. And I think in the Transcendental Aesthetic, when he talks about space, you have to think about space as a whole in order to say, I'm to the right of Hanne. So this is a local spatial relation. But for this to be a thought that I can have, I have to have global space, you know, presupposed. Now, there's a lot of philosophical move about, you know, this is not a space out there, but an ideal. I mean, you know all these things. But the tendency to start with the totality of being and to regard this as a precondition for our thinking about it is definitely in Kant, and I think he returns to it at the end of his life. Then there's something else. And, you know, Kant is not the only person. Kant is a staggering, monumental version of this. But Cantor was like that, and let me not drop too many names. There have been other great thinkers, maybe even Gödel. I mean, great thinkers who thought about the universe as a whole and had this instinct that the primacy of the totality is there, and then we understand ourselves in our role in and place in that totality, including mankind, you know, being prior to me and you. And that doesn't mean there's no ethics in it. The ethics flow, as in Spinoza, from that recognition that I'm a limitation of the all-powerful and so on. So religion cannot be avoided. Religion now is not going to the synagogue on Friday or, you know, on Saturday or Sunday or whenever it is that you go and, you know, what you put here and what you put there. Religion is this recognition of the overall cosmic being and your being a local manifestation and in the image, as it were. So let me just say, then there is this other thing, because that's the duality that you ask. And I believe that you're into this. And I believe, as I said, that Kant himself was into it. Though I think a lot of apostles of Kant lost it. The way a lot of apostles of Jesus lost the message of love and started writing rules and constitutions. There is in Kant and in many of his apostles the craving, the obsession with systems and justification. Like he's a lawyer. The epistemology has to be, you know, within the bounds of this, and then the morality has to have, the principles have to be universal in the following form. And of course, the aesthetic judgments have, even though they are not in a certain sense, cognitive judgments of the ordinary sort. They still have to be a priori in a certain, you know, all these things. This is, I think, lost of the first thing that I was talking about. So a lot of times you say as if, in the picture that I was trying to draw on the other, there's no as if. It's not, it's as if, you know, I'm free. Either I'm free or I'm not. And either it's beautiful or not, and either it's good or not. And there's something almost cynical once you go to the as if. So it serves a certain role in our communication. But in the end, someone says, and is it beautiful? And then you say, this is beyond what I can talk about. So to summarize, I think that we are in very deep contact with some reality with capital R, and I would even call it infused with religion in the relevant sense of cosmic being. But I think modernity has sinned. That's the original sin. And that's why I offer you a counter-apple. To form systems, analytic philosophy that we all do is a prime example, that it's going to all happen inside some sort of axiomatic system. We've got premises and we've got logic and we're not allowed, you know. It's like being in court. Certain moves are okay. And I think not only has it been missing on some of these biggies, and this is my political remark now to stop. So far was theory. I think that a lot of what we see in the political domain, so this opens now a big window to the collapse of what we call liberalism and its modes of thinking, which are very individualistic and self-oriented and reason to our rights and so on, and the swing of a lot of crowd to what we call populism and so on. So that's a big topic, but I'll just food for thought, is our own doing. It's because we went into these systems that are very rationalistic and clever and argue everything and justify, but a missing contact with the fundamentals of life that we're forcing a lot of people to go wrongly, as the case, because it's not satisfying, not just in the sense that the ice cream is not tasty, but because one cannot exist in that way. The disappearance of religion and God and overall nature and beauty in an immediate sense is a force of life. It's what he said. It's the power of life, and it's missing somehow. That's the point, that where I feel we differ. You don't feel that we're missing something?
No, I think the trouble is that if we give up the idea of different kinds of judgments and the conditions for the possibility of those judgments, the justification system that you were talking about, that knowledge means certain kind of a thing, and religious faith is a qualitatively different kind of a thing. It's a different kind of a judgment. And the judgment of beauty is yet another kind of a judgment. And these should not be assimilated into one model. If we don't take this on board, then we run the risk of, for example, assimilating religious faith into the evidence-based conception of knowledge, mixing the two, and then inevitably making religion into a superstition, as Wittgenstein says. And I think the same motivation underlies Kant's project, where he says that he has to limit the scope of knowledge in order to make room for faith, in order to guard religious faith, for example, not to make it badly founded sort of beliefs or poorly justified beliefs. And the same for beauty, that if we don't pay attention to the conditions under which we can say that this is a judgment of beauty, if we fail to recognize that a judgment of beauty requires a subjective response and is partly constituted by that subjective response of pleasure I experience when I contemplate the form of the object, and if we fail to sort of grasp the essence of the judgment in this sense, then we run into trouble.
Should
we
I
lose
respond?
Something yeah. significant. We lose that. We lose the judgment of beauty as a judgment of beauty.
Two things. So these are theoretical things a bit in the philosophy of Kant. So you managed to tempt me back with the... So I'll say two things. First, at the meta level and then local. At the meta level, Wittgenstein, Kant, Carnap, you know, a lot of modern great philosophers, even Quine, who's kind of, they keep feeling that Newton and Einstein need protection. You know, they're the Praetorian guard that's going to save science from bullshit. And, you know, science is doing fine. This is like in mathematics, where I grew up, where the foundations, Hilbert and so on, keep telling the mathematician, you need protection within the bounds of proof, and, you know, can we derive this, not just say we have an intuition that the prime numbers are this way or the other. So I just say, I don't think natural science or mathematics, or let's call it cosmology in some big way, needs protection from philosophers who kind of do legal rules, what we're going to say and what not. Empiricists will do that, Hume and so on, and maybe Carnap was, you know, a modern version of that. But natural science is continuous with God. God is not a threat to natural science. Of course, there have been many people, as you know, and as Kant says very nicely in the critique, who have abused it and given silly arguments. Here, you put three premises and God exists. Sure, there have been very bad things in mathematics happening. You know, Frege was doing a lot of silly things inside the foundation of math. Oh, Hilbert, you know, he said arithmetic is complete. So what? So we're going to stop doing it? So So at the meta level, I say to you, there's a kind of very delusional, I think. Kant came from science. I mean, he did cosmology, he did the geometry. He says that even someplace, metaphysicians should not pretend to be mathematicians. This whole idea that our thinking about the world should be contained with a system of nature, and I have to protect Professor Newton or else all else. This to me is childish.
Can I intervene just
briefly? And I say this coming from these domains.
Just briefly. Yeah. I don't think it is science that needs protection. Not at all. So but it's rather religious faith that needs protection and aesthetics, the possibility of a judgment
okay,
of
good,
beauty
good.
That is
it's
not reducible to psychology or sort of empirical responses. It's beauty that needs protection
okay,
so from the side of science.
Yeah, so now, this is a more real threat, and we could see it in modernity, both about morality that's been kind of, you know, I mean, positivists have said this is not meaningful even and so on. But even those in the audience here who believe there's objective good and bad, you know, to torture a child is bad, not relative to this or that or the other. It's not as if it's bad. It's bad. And, you know, the Grand Canyon is beautiful, whether or not there will be human observers or beholders to see it and so on. And please keep it and don't do a big, you know, atomic nuclear reactor project in the middle of it and so on. Okay, and all these things are objective in some sense, or quasi-objective. I want to say you're right that there's been a threat in modernity to demote these things because they don't look like Newton's gravitation laws. But I think that the deeper scientists, and dare I say deeper philosophers, see that it's part of understanding the world. That's our topic, understanding the world, not just give proofs and justification. The way I think even in the legal system that Kant knew a lot about, at the end, a good judge understands the case. Whatever the laws are and the reasonings, you know, understands the protagonist. This guy is lying even though everything is clicking. This reaching of understanding will involve, look, if you look at Einstein or even Heisenberg, who was a positivist and so on, I don't want to get too much into cases, will involve in the morning reflection on the numbers and the sets and the gravitons and so on, and in the afternoon about how all this thing sits together and the beauty that there is in the mathematics that I offered in the morning. We're having a conference here a month from now from the greatest living set theoretician who talks about the absolute infinite universe, sounding religious, like Cantor. And this is a guy who's, you know, a great, great mathematician, but he talks about these cosmological issues. I am aware that a lot of practitioners of science, like a lot of lawyers, say, look, I don't care understanding the case. I care what I can derive from the something. Yes, but I think that philosophers of the size of Kant should have had more faith in the continuity between science, religion, and ethics, and that, yes, there will be attacks by positivists, but we're not protecting at the end these things by making them formal systems of deduction and justification. We're losing something.
We surely have time for questions, but I have one question for each of you. I start with Hanna. You were talking about this when you're talking about Kant, and we get something from the other source you were quoting. Mm. Could you explain a bit further about that? What was he meaning?
The aid from the other from another source.
Yes.
Well, the point there is that if we look at nature from the viewpoint of knowledge, and this would be the segmentation that I think Joseph is reacting against. But if we accept Kant's idea that the viewpoint of knowledge shows nature to us as a mechanistic system that is determined by laws of nature, then there is no hope that we can actually achieve our goals, achieve our purposes in the world. I may wish to do something, I have a good intention, but there is no guarantee that the world will comply, and it is, as Wittgenstein says, the world is independent of my will, and my will is left in this other realm of the noumenal or the intelligible world, not in contact with nature. So what Kant is saying in that quote is that Christianity sees this gulf between my will, that is subject to the moral law, and nature, and sees the hopelessness of our attempt to bring about the highest good, promote the highest good in the world, but then at the same time gives us this promise that given that there is an intelligent will behind the world itself, the world has been created by a God, then perhaps nature as it is may come and be hospitable to our moral efforts, so that we can actually achieve what we want to achieve and bring goodness and happiness together. So the aid from the other sources, it's the source would be the supersensible source. It would be God.
Right, thank you. And now, because we have short time, so Joseph, you were writing about this beauty, and then you made arrow tomorrow. And I couldn't quite, I don't know, maybe somebody else who was in your lectures would understand the jump from beauty to moral. So could you please explain it a bit further? Do you understand my question?
Totally. But I want to answer the question that Hanna answered, because I thought the question was very interesting.
My answer wasn't so good.
Yeah.
But you only have 5 minutes for this. Sorry.
You're kind of anxious about me.
I have to.
I can pass it. We can just, it's late, yeah. Let me not answer any question. Go ahead, they have time, because people will have to go.
Yeah, I pass explaining the morality to beauty.
It will take time. Let people come in. I will probably insert my stuff anyway, yeah. Go ahead.
So, if anyone, yeah, you have the microphone. So, if there's people in the audience who want to have questions, try to formulate is as a question, not is F. Make a question so it's short and understandable.
Come on, there's so many Kantians in the audience. I mean, you're kind of being shy.
Maybe you need to answer the question about the aid from another source.
I want to say something about what you said, because it's part of this point where I don't like the trickery of Kant. The independence of the world from our will, and as a symbiotic move, he offers the independence of our will from the world.
From the viewpoint of knowledge.
Yeah, okay.
Only from the viewpoint of knowledge.
Let me just say this. I think that in some sense the dualism, mechanistic and purposive, is our own making. Because I'm in the world, if anything is, like this microphone. I am different than this microphone. The world is not independent of my will, because I can do things to the world. I can break this microphone, or I can move it, and so on. Or I can, as we know, we can destroy the world. We've gotten to the point that we can, and we do it. And that's why Dostoevsky 150 years ago said, beauty will save the world, meaning the world needs saving. For Mars, maybe.
Yeah, but do you
so we have a lot of power.
But are you denying that there is some point in the contrast, which is the contrast between nature and the supersensible applied to ourselves, namely, or the on nature and the teleological viewpoint applied to ourselves? Because I sure can think of myself as an empirical creature. I can observe myself, and there can
be I don't know. Empirical is a technical
blood test or whatever, and then I'm approaching myself as an empirical creature out there in the world, an object of knowledge. But at the same time, but I can also adopt this teleological perspective on myself and see myself as an agent. Don't you think that this is a good contrast to have?
No. But not because I'm reductive about either. I think there's nothing super sensible. I think, and that doesn't mean there's no God or world. It means that they're sensible. You know, Descartes says, when I see the little wave come on the beach, I see the whole ocean. I experience the whole ocean, not just the little wave. Mm-hmm. And I think when I experience the distance you have from me, I experience all of space. I don't have a little snapshot of it, or an impression as you would have, but I'm in contact and I experience. So there's much more to our experience and sensibility than the official doctrines of Kant allow. Because we're in contact all the time with manifestations of the biggie. It's as if you saw just my elbow and you said, I never saw Joseph Almog. Yes, you did. You cannot identify me in a police thing, but you have been in contact with a part of Joseph Almog and thus with... And I think we're in contact with space and the world and God in that form. And I say this not ironically about God. So I think the idea that we're not in contact with God should be separated with the idea, can we write a definition as we do for the something something, when we do a model with attributes, you know, the way Spinoza tries to do both contact and definitions and so on? Probably not, but you know, a lot of subjects that are very deep in mathematics, such as natural numbers, cannot be defined. You know, we have them in contact. We can define a class of models, but it's not the natural numbers. And so I feel that a lot of the dualisms, a bit like the mind-body dualism of Descartes, who's my favorite hero, that I never understand why he was into, are forced in the sense that I think, I'm not a reductionist, you know that. I think we have contact with God and the world as a whole. We don't have images, like passport images for God and so on. But, you know, I haven't seen the back of my friend here, you know.
It's a new impression.
But I already was in contact with him before. And I want to say, if we afforded that form of experience with the harmony of nature and how things sit in nature, including our role in it, I think we would not be in the business of demoting nature and God to, you know, oracular, and then invent something that's a demigod, which is our free will, which where I am with Jung, that the more I look into my will, myself, my autonomous, you know, I could do original acts like a god, that seems to me like a compensation to a child, sort of. I mean, if that's my freedom, so there's a kind of give and take here. The more you demote nature and God, in a sense, beyond experience, you're going to create something very artificial that you can call freedom of will, and that, you know, people can get excited that because they can derive things and responsibilities from this and so on. But I think if we kept ourselves, like Spinoza urges, and in a way Dostoevsky urges, because they're connected, that all my life, all my existence is within one world, the only world there is. I'm an agent in it. I'm not a microphone. But I'm not a demigod, kind of an angel that came down to the world of microphones either. And I think part of the description that Newton may not have offered, but that will be a complete description of nature, is the fact that I am not like a ball that's falling from a window and you calculate the gravitation. There is a way that when you drop me from a window, I just fall, because I'm an agent. I can do things to stop myself from falling from the window and so on. And that's part of the description of nature. It's not the description of another realm.
Sure. I'm not denying that we are in contact with the world as it is. The only thing I'm saying or perhaps attributing this idea to Kant, that there are different ways in which we can approach the world.
We can do abstractions.
No, we make different kinds of judgments of it.
Well, I think, I mean, this is one of the things that we talked about in other places, where is it true that the judgment that something is beautiful is really different than the judgment that something is on the table?
Yes.
Kant thinks it's fantastically different.
Of course.
Why? Why is it so different?
Because in the second case, the mug is on the table, we are making a determining judgment depending on a concept, and everybody can agree, okay, there is a cup on the table.
And there's going to be disputes about that.
We share the concept of a cup, and we share the concept of a table, and we can come to agreement, and it's a relatively trivial thing. However, when I see that this piece of music is beautiful, I'm saying something different. I'm not only attributing a property to that performance, but I'm saying something about myself as well. I'm saying something about the relation I have with that piece of music or the performance thereof. That the form of that musical performance is related to my pleasure in a necessary way.
Okay.
So it's a different kind of a judgment.
I have things to say about that, but you guys, if you want to come in, that's your time now, because you're just doing spectator sport. You have to flex your muscles here. Okay, here's a guy. He's a brave guy.
I'm a construction worker, so if my question is somewhat out of the line, just say it. I was wondering that you mentioned about that we cannot, according to your opinion, Professor Almog, give attributes to God or say things about God. Did I understand you right? I mean, so if we cannot say things or true propositions about God, then how can we make that proposition in the first place? It seems to be circular to me, at least. Thank you.
Yes, it's a very good question. I didn't say all the things that you said. I said only sort of half of them. So for instance, according to me, and I don't say this ironically, we can say about God that he exists. And it's a true proposition. It's a very important proposition. And that he's the author of my being. If God didn't exist, I wouldn't. Or anything else. What I was relating to is not something specific to God, but to any real thing. Namely, that philosophers have tried, and in this respect, certain theologies have followed philosophy. And I think both philosophy and theology have followed their ideal model, which is mathematics or geometry, to define what we're talking about. So instead of saying, I'm talking about Hanne, that before I would be able to talk about Hanne, I would say Hanne is the unique individual in the whole world that has properties A, B, C. And then I would be talking in some sense about this collection of attributes. And of course, if there isn't a unique collection, as other philosophers have pointed out, I'm in jeopardy. I cannot talk about her because maybe it's about these other things and all that. And I say what applies to Hanne applies to God. But in both cases, I can talk about Hanne and I can talk about God. But in both cases, when I so talk, when I mean like see or direct contact, it should not be analyzed as having in front of me defining attributes, because these defining attributes are not the real thing. You know, even if there was a set of attributes, you know, a person with blonde hair, smiling at Joe Spalmer, whatever. Okay, that's not what I'm talking about when I talk to him. Okay, so that was the point.
God is not reducible to...
Yes, to the contrary, we can and we need, in order to talk about other things, to talk about God, the thing, the being, but it's not reducible to properties. And I'll tell you this, if you're a construction worker, you should be hired as a philosopher, because I've never seen a construction worker so interested in these things. You're doing well.
I have a question for you, Joseph, because you were talking about that if I see your elbow, I've seen you.
Yeah.
But I was thinking about that. Does it mean that I would know you? Because that's quite a difference. I might have seen a part of you, but there's need communication because I see you for today and Hanne also for the first time, but I just barely know your title. I've seen you on YouTube twice. But to know you, I would need some kind of communication. And when it comes to God, then it needs, how does this communication come about?
Okay, that's also that continues your question in some sense. The question, so 2 points. Do you want to say something about this? I've talked a lot. Yeah. I think you're right that when we move to knowledge, new complications arise. Partly you could see it in the language, in languages like French or German.
I didn't say knowledge, I just say computation.
You said, I know you. Do I know you?
Yeah, of course, yeah.
Okay, so I want to separate two senses of know that are in the language. I don't know how it's in Finnish. But there's kennen and wissen, or connaître et savoir. You definitely connaître me, because you are in contact with me. Now, do you know a lot of truths about me? Do you know how much I weigh and where was I born? Well, that's something else. That's a lot of properties, and maybe if you read something about me, you know, in the file of the rector, then you'll know more. Sometimes you have a lot of knowledge of propositions and no acquaintance. Sometimes you have acquaintance and no knowledge of propositions. And I would say in the case of God, as what's your name?
Nico.
Yeah. The excellent question of Nico. In all our singular thinkings about particular things, the connaître, on my view, precedes the knowledge of predicates, of attributes. So first, I have to be able to have this thing, so to speak, on my radar, have it in me, have it in mind, and then I can say, oh, he has a black jacket, and he's blonde, and he's 6 feet tall. And you know, I might be wrong about a lot of these things. I'm still talking about Nico if I say, Nico is from Turku, maybe he's from Salo. And in this respect, I think you're right, that communication seems to depend on getting a lot of properties right. That is, that, you know, so you say to me, and who is this Hanne that you're talking to me about? And I say, she's the professor of philosophy from Helsinki University, and it happens that she's not. She's the professor of logic from Helsinki University. I still talk about her. It's true that for communication, for a sense that we're talking about the same thing, common properties help. But remember that a lot of times we're talking about the same thing. For instance, you say, Hanne is the best lecturer I've ever heard. And I say, what about me, you know? And we are talking about the same thing, even though we attribute to her different properties. So the idea that communication only happens through shared predicates, I would dispute. Yeah, but it's a pressure.
Yeah,
it's
but that wasn't my question. I was more like, because I'm married and I have a wife, so the only thing, of course I can send a text message, but the way I get to know her is by living with her, having a relationship with her. So it's not only about sending text messages to her.
Well,
and she has some kind of attributes.
You're raising more and more deep questions, and some of them are delicate even, because you may live 40 years with your wife and not know her.
Yeah, of
course. Did it occur to you?
Yeah, but it doesn't.
One day she goes away and you say, Jesus, I was 40 years with this person and I didn't know them, right? Which is not true. They had daily. So it depends what you mean by know. You know, the Bible said that you know someone when you slept with them. You can sleep with someone and not know them at all.
Yeah.
And you can know someone and not sleep with them. So it depends what, you know, knowledge. There's a lot of levels of knowing. So that's
me. And also what knowledge is used when in translations.
I wanted to say about God, because Nico, your good question. Don't leave the room. The idea that we can't know God or about God is not correct. Kant says it in the Critique of Pure Reason, but earlier in a beautiful essay before that, he actually shows that we know a lot about God. He locates the fact that there must be in the universe something that's not like me and Hanne, contingent, accidental, that's a necessary being. And then he goes to town to show that this thing, you know, is intelligent and this thing, you know, is necessary and eternal. And I mean, a lot of things So I think we're very pessimistic when we say, look, if it's not like this, that I can measure and touch, I wouldn't know it. That's not correct. I mean, we know about space and time, and it's very hard to know, but we know a lot. Not by touching, you know, it involves very general contact with space and time and developing very deep theories of the invariance of nature and whatever. So it depends what you mean by know. I have been working with Tero for 4 years. It wouldn't surprise me to discover a lot of things about it. But still, I think I know it. And I surely can communicate to you and embarrass him a lot of things I know about. So it depends what exactly. If you mean complete knowledge, that you know every property and with certainty, I don't think we know anything like that, not even mathematical objects.
My comment would be that I know barely any theologian, as I myself, that would say that they know everything about God. But then in theology, there's also an idea that God in some way defines himself, which is in incarnation. He gets in place, he gets a body, and so on, which means that, because there's also used this argument that God should not be put in a box, because then for me it sounds like you that we don't put these attributes to God, because then we put God in the box.
Well, I think the attempt to define God, as Kant says very correctly in criticizing the ontological argument, was not by a person who did not believe in God. It's because he believed in God that he thought the ontological argument is literally blasphemous. You know, putting all these little, like a theory, you know, make a little theory and do deductions like we're doing logic or something. So I think part of the contact that I feel I have with God or with the world as a whole is I can see some of the properties. There will always be properties that I do not see. I said this even in the case of mathematics, there will always be propositions that are not settled by the system of attributes. And I think the person, you should have known that, the person that I quoted after Dostoevsky was the Pope, when he talked about how God through beauty shows himself in the world. Now, I don't know whether you are a fan of the current Pope, but he's a very brave person, and some people in the church are very critical of him. But this is a person, and he's not the first Pope, Benedict XVI already was into this, took the Dostoevsky literal phrase, beauty will save the world, and have tried to do something with it, whereas analytic philosophy probably makes fun of it because they don't have an object that they can surround with a definition.
Now it's getting quiet. So do we have any more questions? I'm getting over time. Then I would like, we're going to close this event, but I would like to fill in the form. Mika, where is it? It's over there. So please fill in the form, because then Veritas Forum will get feedback about this event, and maybe you can suggest topics that you would like to be dealt in Veritas Forum, so please fill in it. And there's also will be coffee and tea after that, and maybe Joseph will continue his lecture.
thank you very much.
Thank you very much.